There are two types of eviction. The concept of eviction manifests itself in a double barrel format in our law. One is eviction post a criminal process. The other is eviction post a civil process. Now, it's regulated by a number of laws in the country. I'll touch on them briefly. Now, in order to understand eviction, it's very important for one to understand the historical basis, background behind evicting people in their homes in our country. Before independence, before our constitutional dispensation, we had a situation where you could simply be evicted without judicial oversight. What does that mean? It means if your landlord, if you default on your rent, or if your landlord stops liking you, or if your landlord gets someone who's ready to pay more than you, they can simply evict you despite the existence of a contract. Or what happened was you go to work and then you come back and your flat is simply locked and your belongings are outside. Now, this situation still happens today. People continue to take the law into their own hands despite laws that have come in or despite judicial intervention that has manifested itself after our independence. Now, as we all know, before independence, we were under the administration of the administrative general of the South African administration. This guy was responsible for what was then called a Southwest Africa. So, because of the existence of a certain proclamation, all laws that were passed in South Africa, by extension, also applied to our country. One of those laws it's reflected on the list of laws that has been handed to you. In fact, it's reflected more in detail in the AR Legal Forum's point of law. And it's a heading that it appears to be the sixth page of also. Sixth page. In fact, it's the fifth page. There it says eviction, squatters proclamation number 21 of 1985. What was the reason for creating this proclamation? It was simply to regulate the class areas that existed then, in the sense that if you were a person, a colored, as we were then known, if you were a colored and you were found to be, or if you were found to be trespassing upon land which is reserved for white people, you could be prosecuted, evicted by virtue of this act. Now, the funny thing is, until today, this proclamation is valid in our country. But the people who created it have since done away with it, and that is the South African Parliament. What happened in South Africa? Immediately when they passed when they enacted their constitution, they included a right to housing. Myself, and a number of other young lawyers, including other senior lawyers, have committed ourselves to assisting any young person who has been arrested pursuant to the provisions of this proclamation. Pro bono. Now, for free. Of course, the proclamation which I just referred to now creates a specific offense. My colleagues who are prosecutors will testify. There are not many jurisprudential analysis on this act, because those who are arrested and charged under this act, their cases are disposed of in the lower courts, they never reach the high court, and therefore they never reach the law reports. So it's very difficult to find jurisprudential analysis on this proclamation. However, we have analyzed it in depth and we have found that it is riddled with a number of weaknesses and loopholes, which we will not share now because we don't advise the police. We are ready to use this proclamation should anyone be arrested. Also, we have also seen that the act contravenes a number of constitutional provisions, including the right to dignity, and it can easily be set aside by constitutional attack. Why do I say it can easily be done so? Brave and landless Namibians attack a specific provision of this proclamation, namely section 4.1 and 3 of the proclamation, on the basis that it is inconsistent with the Namibian constitution. That case is cited as Shanika and others, this is the Windhoek City Police and others. So, Shanika then were upheld by the Supreme Court of this country, namely the Supreme Court. They succeeded in setting a portion of that proclamation aside. But they only attacked that portion because it's what affected them at that point. We are of the view that this whole proclamation can and should be set aside on the basis that it is unconstitutional. What do we propose should replace this proclamation? We propose an act of parliament which may be called the Prevention of Illegal Eviction from an Unlawful Occupation of Land. This is an act similar to what has been proposed in South Africa. We were debating it with my colleague Nafimani Arengo during the break. He was saying he's tired of this copy and paste thing from South Africa to Namibia. But I read the act, in fact, we read the act. It makes perfect sense. It makes perfect sense that you shouldn't evict people unless you have alternative housing accommodation for them. It makes sense that people should generally not be evicted into a situation of homelessness. Temporary alternative accommodation should be provided to those facing homelessness by the relevant public authorities, usually municipalities. People facing eviction from their homes should be given a meaningful opportunity to participate in the resolution of the eviction dispute. Thirdly, evictions which might lead to homelessness are never just private disputes. They always involve the state, whose duty to provide emergency housing may be triggered by an eviction. This means that we've seen a number of people in Kaputura being evicted from their homes because one of their brothers sold the house to property developer or any capitalist. Now, if you create an act, it makes provision for the intervention of the state in disputes like that. Now you find a situation where the local councillor of that section in Kaputura comes on the scene, usually it's for political reasons, brings NBC, and then they are seen to be doing something. But once NBC is gone, the deputy sheriff continues and takes the old woman or old man out of the house. But if you create an act, all these officials will have an enabling provision or an enabling framework within which they can operate. So they simply don't go there because they are councillors, but they go there because they are officials who are earmarked and who are empowered by a specific provision in a particular act of parliament. So those are our suggestions, three tiered suggestions. Firstly, firstly, you amend the constitution. You augment it. You add a right. You don't detract. You don't diminish, as stated by my colleague, Mr. Anerudo. Simply add a right to housing. We don't care whether you make it an article on its own or you make it as a sub-article under Article 16. We don't care. We just want it in there. Secondly, you repeal, as we have repealed, so many laws which were enacted by the authorities acting under their apartheid policy. You repeal the Squatters Proclamation Act. It has no place in a democratic country in a constitutional dispensation such as ours. Thereafter, so as not to create a legal lacuna, you enact an act of parliament within which all evictions can be carried out lawfully and decently with regard to the public interest.